Hey everybody, it's Laz again, still here in the UK, traveling around. Exciting, I got to meet one of my students, right? I met him by the London Eye. It was great to see him. We had a great conversation. Nice individual, moving forward in his IT career. I wish him the best of luck, like I wish you all the best of luck. Even though I'm traveling, I'm still doing what I need to do. I am working for you, okay? I created this multiple lab that I'm going to leave you with key topics such as spanning tree, VTP, VLANs, all right, all these things, DNS, it will be in this lab, and a lot of troubleshooting, because things don't go the right way the first time, which is good, and you need to think that that's a good thing, because in IT, if everything goes right the first time, they don't need you. You need to know. You need things to happen so you know how to fix them. And that's what we're going to get into. We're going to be troubleshooting there as well. So take advantage. For those of you that haven't taken, I'll leave you this. For those of you that haven't taken the CCNA 20-125, remember, you're still in time. Kind of late, but you're still in time. April 3rd through the 16th is my 14-day course. All right? You still can go to globed.net and sign up for it. Okay? But enough said, let me leave you now with the lab. I hope you enjoy it. Hey everybody, welcome to the lab. All right, what are we going to be doing here? As you can see there, put a little list to remind me. We may do some more. We're definitely going to go over STP, you know, briefly over STP, VTP, VLAN, trunking, inter-VLAN, DHCP on the router, and DNS. All right. Now, I set up, as you can see over here on the right, a server that's going to be running as a DNS and as an email. All right, I set it up that way. I'll show you how I did it. You just go to services, you go to email, just make sure the SMTP and POP3, whatever, are on. You get your domain name, you create your user account. That is awesome. On the desktop, and I did it here on both of these desktops as well as here. You go to email and you create the account for who you want to receive the email for, the user account, like you would have on a regular desktop. So I have that set up as well as DNS. So my DNS is last.com. So when you're setting up your email and asking for a domain, that's why that is. And you can verify that indeed your DNS is resolving by going to the browser and saying last, well, in your case, whatever you want to do, but in my case, last.com. And voila, comes out globed.net, affordable education to students around the globe. Yes, that's our goal. All right. So you can go ahead and check that out and do that. All right. Now, these two PCs, when we say DHCP and a router, I'm going to open them up so you can see what I put. I put them to receive a DHCP address. So they're getting what? And a PIPA. Very good. Very good. And a PIPA 169.254. You don't care what's at the end. All right, it assigns itself, right? The computer, you didn't assign it one statically. You didn't get one dynamically, not yet. So it assigned itself one. Please do not try and configure your network with a PIPAs. All right, they're not routable, so don't do it. All right, so we're going to go into now, before I was about to start, but I know somebody asked a question on this right here. Elias, you're using a layer 3 switch, man. Listen, the CCNA, you do not have anything to do with layer 3 switches. For your CCNA certification, nothing to do with layer 3 switches. I said it twice already, if I haven't said it more times in the past. All right, when you get to your CCNP switch, yes, layer 3 and layer 2 switching, more likely layer 3 for CCNP switch, but not for CCNA. But I'm just going to put it in there just so you can be happy that I have a layer 3 switch on there. But I'm not going to use it as a layer 3 switch. And as I go, I'll show you how I can do it. All right, because I have not said no switch port. Therefore, is a switch port port. And it's going to be like a normal layer 2. It'll do layer 2 functions. I'm not going to do any routing with that particular switch. But just to please the eye, I put a layer 3 switch there. And so it looks like the Cisco 3-layer model of the core distribution and access, right? So layer. So anyway, we're gonna start with this guy. Now, as you can see, one of the first things that I like to do, especially those of you been with me for a while, is that this particular switch right here, whether it's a layer 2 or layer 3, I like to make it my root bridge. And that's all you do. Stop worrying about what you do at work, okay? CCNA.
I want to make this guy the roof bridge. That is your concern, okay? That is your concern. So I'm gonna go in here. I'm going to maximize the window. I'm gonna go into the CLI. And the reason we're in privilege mode or global configuration mode is because I changed the name in config mode, right? I gave it a name there. But so I'll go back one so you can see. Okay, and I'm gonna do show spanning tree. Right, so show span to you. This will show you that this is not the root bridge. Did I look at the lights wrong? Oh, that's right. This is not the root bridge. You see how that amber light is right there? So anything that's facing a switch, right? Your neighbor port, it's amber. You're not the root switch, root bridge, I should say. This is the root bridge. But let's take a look at this one since we clicked on it. So this information right here, and the moment we'll have only one VLAN, I haven't created any other VLANs. This is information about the root bridge. Now you're saying, well, Laz, how did it know to pick this particular switch to be the root bridge? Well, it's because you're using, it's looking at this right here, the MAC address of the switch, okay? The MAC address is, it'll look for the lowest MAC address. The first thing it looks at, it runs an election, says, hey, I need a root bridge. So let me look at the priority numbers. I can't because every switch has that default priority number. Just for your info, how does it get that number? This is one of the values that is allowed for you to put in, but then it will add the VLAN identifier. If it's VLAN 1, 32.769. If it's VLAN 2, it will add it, it will be 32.770 and so forth. Okay, so in this case, it just added the VLAN 1 to it. That's why it's 32.769. So everybody has the same one. All right, so it's gotta look at the lowest MAC address to make a decision. So this information over here is about the root bridge. This information over here is about this particular switch that we're on. As you can see, that the MAC address is 00E. Oh, it's larger than 000. So therefore, this cannot, and apparently, well, it has a root bridge. It's not blocked. This was supposed to be, well, no, there's a root bridge. As you can see, it has designated, okay, ports and a root port at the moment, okay, because this is not the root bridge. It would be the root bridge. Both ports would be designated. And it's getting confusing for me because I usually look at this as a root bridge, all right? But just so you know, okay, so this port, port number 23, okay, port number 23 is facing the root bridge. And let's take a look at that too. So where's port 23? Right here. It's facing the root bridge. So that'll give you a hint right then and there that any port that's a root port will be facing the root bridge. So this is the root bridge right here. We'll take a look at that next. But again, it didn't choose the switch because of the MAC address, because it was higher than this guy right here, which is the root bridge. So let's take a look at that. Let me close that so we don't have a million things open. Maximize that. Go to the CLI. Type in the same command from privilege mode. Show spanning tree. Yes, I tab a lot. You're allowed to tab. All right, as you can see, it says, hey, I am the root bridge, or this is the root bridge. And take a look at the MAC address, right? And it's the MAC address of the switch, the same thing. So this is the root bridge, and all ports are designated forwarding, all of them, okay? There, a root bridge will never have, one, a block port, two, a root port. They will all forward information. That's its purpose, okay? And the cost means, hey, this is fast Ethernet. We're using fast Ethernet. If it would be four, it would be gigabit, okay? The lower the cost, the faster the port, right? And what you're using, gigabit or, you know, or anything higher, all right? Faster. So in this case, it's 19. We're using fast Ethernet. That's all that means. All right. So again, this is the root bridge because of the lowest MAC address. Now we saw the one previous. It was 00E, correct? This wasn't the case for this one. So let's take a look at the very last switch. All right. Let's go to the CLI. Type in the same command. Enable spanning tree. Oh, show. Haha. Show spanning tree, okay? And you can see that this is, but you can say, well, Laz, this is 00E as well. And this is the one that it chose to block. Wasn't the other one the same? Okay, well, let's see. Okay, so it's not in the first one because they look like both were the same. Let's take a look then at what this one was. Well, let's maximize this so we can see. So at 00E, that's the same. Then it starts with B084. Okay. And this one was 00EF932. So right there, they want to start with B. This one starts with F. So again, this is, has a higher MAC address. Therefore, it chose to block a port. Now you say, okay, well, wait a minute. Spanning tree chose a root bridge in this scenario, in this case, is looking at the MAC address as the lowest because all the priority numbers are the same. So it went to the lowest MAC address. Cool, I got that. But now that I looked at this switch that has the highest MAC address, why that particular port? Why that particular port? Well, that particular port, F022, okay, remember, this is the root bridge as of right now, okay? A blocked port cannot face the root bridge. A blocked port cannot face the root bridge. If you look at port 21, it is a root port. I said it already. All ports facing the root bridge are root ports, okay? So that port cannot be blocked. So the port that was blocked was one facing away from the root bridge. And then the rest of them, obviously, these are going towards the axis are designated 40. Cool. All right, but I don't want that. I don't want that. I want to make this guy my root bridge. So what do? I change the priority. That is the easiest, fastest way to do it. So I go to config T. Now we're going to do one instance of spanning tree across all our VLANs. So we know we have VLAN 1, and let's look at it. Do show VLAN brief. Now you cannot do the do command in the exam, in the certification exam, but you can do it in the real world. So you do a do right from where you're at, no need to go back. Do show VLAN brief, and I do this for the sake of, you know, time and what have you. We have VLAN 1, but we will be adding VLANs 100 and VLAN 101. So we want to do one instance across all VLANs. Well, what do we do? Spanning tree VLAN 1, comma 100, comma 101, priority, and then we're gonna put the lowest priority that you can ever have, which is 0. It starts at 0 and increments by 4096. And you hit enter. I'm gonna do a do WR, and people ask me, hey Lance, how often do I save? Because that's what it is. You're writing, you're saving, like a copy run starts, the same thing, but I'm just doing it quickly. So I'm gonna do a do show spanning tree. That's the only bad thing. I can't tab from here. So spanning tree. Really? Oh, show spanning tree. Boom. Okay. And you can see that again, this is now, even though this has a higher MAC address than the one previous to that. Okay. That was 000000A. This is 00E, is a higher MAC address. Now it says, well, you have the lowest priority number. And therefore, I will choose you as the root bridge. Now, Cisco has something called a terminology. It's the bridge ID. And the bridge ID, it is a combination of the priority number and the MAC address. So you may see questions asking about the bridge ID, and it will be really just, okay, who has the lowest bridge ID? And it will be a combination of the lowest priority number and the lowest MAC address. And then you choose appropriately, okay? And you can see that this is the root bridge now. All ports are designated 40. So who did it decide to still has the highest MAC address? But now it chose the other port before this port was blocked. Now this one is. Okay, because it cannot face the root bridge. Okay. All right. Now, the type of spanning tree. Everybody wants to use the latest and greatest of everything. Rapid span entry is one of the things we want to do. Do not mix and match. If you're going to run rapid PVST, then everybody is running rapid PVST. Why? If you don't, you're going to run into communication problems, right? That backward compatibility thing, yeah, doesn't work very well. So if you have one running rapid PVST, have all your switches running rapid PVST. And this is how difficult it is. So, you know, spanning tree mode, there it is, rapid PVST, enter. And you do that to all your switches, all right? You do that to all your switches to make sure that, hey, we're running PVST. And how would you look at it? You would say show spanning tree, and then you would say, let's say summary. And you can see right here that it says this is the root bridge switches in rapid PVST mode right here by doing a show spanning tree summary, right? Taking a look at everything. This is what you're interested in. Don't be looking at everything else and all this craziness, all right, that you do at work. Has nothing to do with it, all right? So we did that. Cool, we're in the core switch. So we took care of span entry. Now we have one instance of span entry going across all VLANs, but the VLANs are not created. So what I'm gonna do is, I wanna create the VLANs on the core switch, but I'm not gonna assign them. And the reason that is because I want them to trickle down to all the switches that I have, okay? So I'm gonna put, go to global config, and I say VLAN 100, that's going to be my faculty VLAN name, faculty. And always verify your work as you go. VLAN 101, enter, name, not Bane, that's from Batman, name 100, okay? Oh, name student, sorry, getting all confused. All right, let's do a do WR. To save it, and right from right here, you can do show. So you can see how cool this do command is. Do show VLAN brief. You don't have to go back to privilege mode, but you guys have to when you're taking your test and do, you know, show commands or ping or copy. So we have the 100 faculty VLAN and the 101 student VLAN. Cool, awesome. We're not assigning them. You see, there's no ports over here that they're assigned with. Now, what we're gonna do is going to the VTP. Some people have been telling me, and this is, I don't know why, they say, oh, VTP is not important, we don't need to do VTP. Why don't you use VTP in the real world? Well, that's why you're having all these issues, because VTP is to maintain the name of your VLANs, especially your native VLAN, contiguous across your entire network. It looks at your VLAN. So VTP is essential. Not to mention that the newest version of VTP, which is VTP version 3, all right, brings in a lot of other features that fixes all the problems with VTP version 2. So you should be running VTP. Do not do that, because one of the main issues, if you want to talk about the real world, all right, is that administrators, text, whatever, hey, we need another switch. Just go to the store, buy one. We'll just plug it in anywhere we want. No, that's not the case. That's not the case. You can't be doing stuff like that. There's a lot of things to it. And one screen you need to be very familiar with, do show VTP. Oh, do show, I'm sorry, I abbreviate too much. Do show VTP stat. It's this screen right here. Okay, as you can see, we're running version 2. That's all it has, version 1 and 2. So we're running version 2. All right. But this screen is extremely important. Now, this looks slightly different from a layer 2 switch to a layer 3 switch. Okay, because here they separate the VLANs, what have you, the operating mode and all that, but it's the same thing, okay? Who just modified you, that's very important to know, and you'll see that once you put in the IP addresses, okay? And then the operating mode that you're in, and do we have a VTP domain name, all right? So again, we don't have a VTP domain name, but we're gonna do it for security purposes. We all wanna be in the same VLAN, and obviously you wanna put a VTP password. Here we're not going to, because it doesn't then allow you to take it out, but in a real world scenario, you would. Now, if you're gonna do this, VTP domain name, every switch needs to be the same one. So if you bring in a rogue switch, not only, because the VTP domain name trickles down, all you need to do is just type it here. But the password, you need to enter it manually on all your switches. Therefore, if somebody brings in a switch from the outside and tries to plug it into one of your ports, they may be able to join the VTP, or try, you know, the VTP domain name won't come down, But if you don't have the password, hey, you cannot join our BTP domain name. All right, you need to know the password. And as far as the operating mode, all switches by default are server, 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 server. Okay, now there's three modes that you need to be aware of. Server, client, and transparent. Server does everything. You can create, delete, change, do whatever you want to a VLAN. All right, you can mess around with the VLAN database. It can receive and send updates. All right, so it can do everything. Clients can send and receive updates, but they cannot mess with the VLAN database. The last one, transparent, which I call greedy one, is the one that will not share its VLAN database and will not update its own database with anybody else's VLAN information. It'll just pass everything on through. It can do everything that the server can do. It just doesn't want to share. It doesn't like sharing and doesn't care about anybody else's. That's why normally that's done through to a remote network of some sort. Okay, so let's create a VTP domain name. Very simple, VTP domain, and we'll call it LAS. No, let's call it Cisco. Okay, there you go. And we look at it again. Do you show? I think I should be in history. Oop, do you show it? There you go. Just by doing up arrow. Now we'll see that we have a VTP domain name called Cisco. All right, and we're running VTP version 2. All right. But again, this is not the most important number you need to be looking at. This is the most important number you need to be looking at. If we're all on the same domain, the one with the highest revision number will update everybody else. This is where you need to be careful. Whether you're in server or client, remember, client will also update everybody else. So if you put in a client switch, which is in the same domain, and you have a higher revision number because you did something on there that updated it, and you put it back in there, guess what? Now that will update that. Obviously, the reason you put it in client, because I know somebody's out there saying, well, Laz, you just said client doesn't mess around with the VLAN database. Why would that revision number go up? And I'm putting you in a scenario where a client has a higher revision number with the same domain name. What would happen? So you understand that the higher revision number will update everybody else, okay? So if everybody's server and you have the higher revision number, you will update everybody else, and I'll show you, okay? So we got the revision number, we have our VLANs, we have our span tree squared away. All we need to do now is trunk. So which ones will be your trunking ports? These three. Why do we need to trunk, Laz? What's the purpose of trunking? Trunking comes from back in the day from telecommunications, where the trunk lines and multiple phone lines can go through there. Well, it's the same thing, except it's not phone lines, it's VLANs. Every VLAN, okay, except the native VLAN. Let's take a look at that so you can see what I mean, what I'm saying. Understand what I mean, see what I'm saying. Do show VLAN brief. All right. By default, the native VLAN, whatever number you want to give it, by default is 1, but you can change that. But the native VLAN can go across access ports or trunked ports. If you're from VLAN 2 to VLAN 1001, then you must go across a trunk port. Why? Because VLAN 1 or the native VLAN, administrative VLAN, management VLAN, whatever you want to call it, okay, it's going to have a PVID, a port VLAN identifier on there that's going to say in its frame, hey, I'm the native VLAN, let me on through, I know who I am, I know where I need to go. Where the other VLANs need to get framed tagged, okay, they need to be tagged. Now, this is a layer 3 switch. Normally, in a layer 2 switch, all you would have to do is switch port mode trunk and the ports would be trunked. But since we're in a layer 3 switch, slightly different. All right, so we're going to go int range, and I picked the ports on purpose. Let me do this. I picked ports 22, 23, and 24. We're going to make a range, int range, F0 slash 22-24. And the first thing you're going to type is switch port. Switch port mode trunk. Nope, that's not the one. Switch port trunk. Here you go. Encapsulation. And now you choose .1Q. You must do this. You must do this in a layer 3 switch because some layer 3 switches support ISL. So you're telling, hey, we're going to use this encapsulation. Now after you've done that, then you can do switch port mode. Oops. Trunk. And you see how everything came up? Didn't come up before, but when you did that. So there's two commands you need to type in a layer 3 switch. Switch port trunk encapsulation .1Q, because ISL is not used anymore. And switch port mode trunk, which is going to trunk all your ports. And how would you look at that? Well, let me just get out of here. Let's go global configuration, get rid of this gibberish, and do show int trunk. And you can see that 22, 23, they have, I did it manually. It's 1Q. 24 is not showing up because it's plugged into the router, and that particular interface in the router is not on, so you're not seeing it. But those ports are trunk. Okay, for now, we're done. All right, now that we're done with that one, let's go to this one right here. Okay, let's maximize it. And what we're going to do is we don't want it to mess around with any of the client's databases, right, or the VLAN database. So we're going to do config T. Right, and that's already named, so we don't have to worry about that. But what we want to do is VTP mode client. All right, and then it's client. And then if you do a do show VTP stat to make sure that it is in client mode. Now, one of the things that I've realized with this particular version of the packet tracer is that it takes time when it's doing things for things to populate down. All right, so that's just the way it is. All right, so we'll try to make it TWR. All right, so what we can do is go here, show VLAN brief. So you can see the VLANs have not gone down, show int trunk, and they should. It just takes time, okay? I did not see anything trunked, showing trunk. Okay, there we go. Nothing. It shows like nothing is trunked when in fact it is. So what we can do is, all right, let's see if we can fast forward through time. Click it a couple times here, fast forward through time. Go back to the switch. Go up arrow, showing trunk, still nothing. Do show VLAN brief. And, oh, oops, show VLAN brief. I'm in privileged mode. All right. So one of the things I want to do is I'll save this configuration. I want to make sure though, show VTP stat, that it indeed is in client mode. Awesome. So we're just going to WR, and then I'm going to reload the switch. Nothing you would do in the real world, obviously. But since this is a simulator, and I've noticed because with regular layer 2 access switches, this doesn't happen. But with this newer packet tracer, I want to put a layer 3 switch, things like this happen. So we need to maybe play around with it a little bit. Remember, it is a simulator, okay? So it has its bugs in it. So let's do a show VLAN brief, see if they came down. They did not. Let's pause the video for a bit and I'll come back when they come up. I'm not gonna do anything different, but restart and reload and all that, but I'm not gonna waste your time with that. So we'll come back to the video when the VLANs populate. Alrighty, and we're back. All right, here are your VLANs. So I did do something. I just didn't feel like waiting anymore. So what I did was I actually went ahead and manually, and I'll show you now, VTP stat, and I added this. This is something that with the layer 2 switches, I never have an issue with in the older packet tracer, where you create a domain name comes on down with the, through the trunk ports. But since it didn't want to do it, I went ahead and created the VTP domain name manually, like we did on the core switch. And then the VLANs came down. Wonderful. All right. And there they are right there. 100 and 101. Now, this is the access switch, right? The access layer. So we're going to go ahead and create a range and we're going to assign the VLANs among other things. All right, so, oh, but very important, conf t, we changed the span tree mode up there. So spanning tree mode, rapid PVST. All right, so let's copy that, make sure that that gets done. All right, so now let's go ahead and do some stuff, right, that deals with STP. We understand that STP is important because it does block ports so it can stop forwarding. So what we're gonna do is, we're gonna go ahead and turn off span tree in the ports that lead to end devices. Not internetworking devices, but end devices such as PCs, all right? So I'm gonna go int range F0/1-15. Now the first objective is to assign the VLAN. This is the faculty switch, switch one. We can rename it if we want to, but we're not gonna do that. All right, we just leave it as switch one. So we're going to do switch, must be an access port, switch port mode access, switch port access, VLAN, and the VLAN would be, for the faculty, is 100. So we'll go ahead and put 100 on there. Awesome. All right, so now they are part of the 100 VLAN, all right? And that's gonna be these two PCs right here. So ports one and port two, here we have ports 1 through 15. So these two guys are gonna be part of VLAN 100, okay? That is great. So now that we're here, in this range is where we can do spanning tree, port fast. Uh-oh, what are we doing? We're turning off span tree on all these ports, as you can see. Okay, now here is, I find it funny, in these layer three switches, they give you every last port that you decided to turn off the spanning tree. It'll give you a warning. We're in an access two. I don't know if it's if the mode of the you know, the version of the packet tracer, or just the fact that the layer three switch is giving you a report. You know the ranges of ports that you're doing it to, but what have you. It says giving you a warning. All right, and this is like, be careful. Do not go ahead and plug in something to these ports as an internetworking device, or you'll create a loop. All right, so to protect against that, which is what we're trying to do, is spanning tree, BPDU guard enable. All right, so what you're doing essentially is like you're putting a guard on these ports, right? And it's looking to see if it sees any bridge protocol data units, because that's what BPDU stands for. And if it does, it will shut down that port. It will shut it down and put it in ER disable. You'll get a million help desk calls, right, to your help desk. Or you get flags up, you have some sort of third-party software actually watching this, or you have, you know, monitoring services watching this, you'll get some sort of beep or something that'll let you know, hey, this port is now down. You need to take a look at it. So you go ahead and then you turn it back on. You get rid of the device that's there, obviously, put back the device that was there, or just, you know, get rid of that device altogether, and then do a shut, no shut, if you want to turn that port back on. All right, if it was a working port to begin with, people do have the bad habit of actually unplugging a computer, an end device, whatever it is, and plugging in, you know, a switch, and then, hey, just go ahead and do it. No. All right. So we're protecting against that. If not, remember, it goes into ERR disable. All right, if it notices BPDUs. Also, but that's for the effective, right? How effective your network is. It's not really doing it for security purposes, but more production purposes, okay? Here, now we're gonna do switch port security, switch port security. That turns it on, and I didn't get an error. Why didn't I get an error? Because there are access ports, and I gotta go all the way up to all these different things, because we went ahead here and turned them into access ports. If you do not do that, right? You did it because you were creating VLANs, and you have to do it, because by default, all ports are dynamic auto. So you cannot set port security on a port that is dynamic auto. It has to be an access port, okay? So now we're gonna go ahead and do switch port security, and we're gonna do MAC sticky. And what that means, plain and simple, it's learning, because switches learn MAC addresses dynamically, but it's, and when you see the MAC address table, it shows it as a dynamically learned address. But if you use the sticky command, it's going to say static. And so it's going to be there until you decide to delete it. All right, so that's what MAC sticky is. So it saves you from actually having to type manually MAC addresses into the switch. Okay, that's what that's there for. And again, CCNA purposes, you're not going to get into 802.1x and all this different craziness with Active Directory and all that. You're not, I know you probably do that at work, but you're not going to do it for the CCNA. MAC sticky, okay? Learns MAC addresses dynamically, shows it in the MAC address table as it was static. It only goes away if you go ahead and actually delete it. But there's other things you can do here. I'm going to up arrow. I'm going to do a maximum. I'm a stickler. One, you got one device, that's it. I don't believe in BYOD, bring your own device. I don't believe in that. All right, I give you a computer, that's the computer you work with, period. That's it, end of story. All right, if there's more computers, obviously, throughout the, if you have an issue, a work laptop, and you have to go to different companies and all that, all this stuff, then yeah, okay, you're allowed, you know, maybe multiple MAC addresses, or you know, you have two, you know, a physical desktop, you have your laptop where you can be mobile and go all over the place, then we'll allow two MAC addresses, but they will be put in there. They will be put in there, and that's it. Once it's learned, you are done, all right? Because that's where 802.1x comes in, but either way, you need to, you know, if you are going to do that, reality of your mobile, you know, you need to have that flexibility. But if you don't, yeah, one, I don't believe in bringing your computer to work. And then if you violate that maximum rule, all right, violation, VIO for short, you will be shut down. That is the preference of Cisco. That's the preference in security. If you're not using a port, why is it on? Shut it down. Restrict, protect, those are your other options. One creates a log, the other one doesn't. Hello? Don't, no. You want to make sure you shut that port down. And this also generates an ERR disable. All right, but now it's doing it for the purpose of security instead of, you know, dealing with production in a network where it's going to create a switching loop, right? The effectiveness of your network. So now here we are done. We did our VLANs. We'll verify. Let's verify. Very important. You need to verify your certification. Let's do a WR, or you guys will do a copy run start, get rid of all this gibberish here. And we'll do a show VLAN brief. Let's take a look at it. You see that the 100 faculty, all right, right here, it's assigned to those ports. Awesome. Okay. Show VTP stat. We see that, hey, we're in the Cisco domain. Great. Okay. All right. That's the only way that things came down. So, okay. And now we're going to do a show int trunk, which you should see the ports that are trunked, which is 22. That's where this switch is attached to. Show port security, show port hyphen security. And you can see that's port security. It's already learned on ports 1 and 2, which is your end devices. And let's take a look at that. Let's take a look at it. Show MAC space address, boom, table. And you can see it shows static, like I told you, right? Static, because that's where the sticky is at. The rest of them, which are trunk ports or what have you, all right, it's going to be right here. These are the VLAN ports. See, it learned this dynamically. It learned this dynamically. It learned this dynamically. All right, so that's just the way it is on these particular ports. Ports 22, ports 22, ports 21. So it learns those particular ones dynamic, right? Or not that it learns it dynamically. It does. It learns all the MAC addresses dynamically. But when you look at the MAC address table, it will say dynamic unless you put it, like we did, a static. Right here using the sticky command for security purposes. And if you violate that, which is all it takes is just one more computer, it will shut down the port or put in ER disable. So cool. We are done for now with this one. Let's do a WR or WR in this case. All right, we're done. Let's minimize that. Well, let's not minimize it. Let's just go straight. Well, we got a whole bunch of them open. Let's close the core switch. Let's close this. We got too many of these things open here. All right, and we got two of the same topologies. This is the one that I'm working, I believe. Let me make sure. Yes, it is. And so we can safely close this one. Don't want to say yes. I don't know. It's kind of scary to say yes. Let's see. Enable, show start. There's no start config present. Oh, that's awesome. So do you want to save any changes? No. All right, but we have this one. Let's check it again. Because Packet Tracer is funky, funky. Show VLAN Briefer, just take a look at that. Easy command, boom, okay, we're safe. Let's save that using our good old floppy disk here, save. All right, and now we go to the next switch and we're gonna do the same exact thing, all right? So let's see what happens. It will be interesting to see what happens. Let's change the mode of span tree to begin with, just to have that done. Spanning tree mode, rapid PVST, awesome. Okay, let's change it to a client, BTP mode, client. Okay, and then let's do a do show VLAN brief. And look, it came down. Okay, so let's take a look at the VTP status. Do show VTP stat. These are commands you better be paying attention to because you need to know it. And there it is, there's Cisco. So you see, I didn't have to do it manually. I actually did it by itself. I did not do that manually. Okay, it did it by itself. All right, so it's a packet tracer thing. Okay, so it went down. So now all we really need to do is assign the 101, right? Because this is the student switch. So I'm not gonna change the name of it. All right, it's switch two. So let's go int range. All right, and we're gonna do F0/1 through 15. I always pick the same ports. Switch port mode access, switch port access, VLAN, in this case, 101. Awesome. While we're here, let's do the spanning tree. So spanning tree, port fast, woo, warning. And then spanning tree, port, not port fast, port, on up spanning tree, switch port, port security, up arrow, Mac sticky, up arrow, all right, max one, and then violation is gonna be shut, all right, awesome. So now we do protect all these ports as we turned off spanning tree. We're gonna do spanning tree. I should have done that before. Spanning tree, BPDU guard enable. Should have done that before I did the security, but it doesn't really matter the order, as long as you get it done. All right, so we're essentially done. Everybody's assigned their particular thing, their particular VLAN, and let's take a look at it. Do show VLAN brief. All right, we're in the same domain. Do show VTP stat. Okay, cool. All right, we are fine. Same domain. Everybody's assigned to their VLAN. Cool. Now all we need to do is do inter VLAN connectivity, which we do it on a layer 3. I could do it here if I want to, but I don't want to. I'm going to do it here. All right. So let's go ahead. So I enable routing on the layer 3 switch. I did not turn off the port because I could say no switch port, now it becomes a routing port. All right, it's still a switch port, it's acting as layer 2. So we'll enable config t host name r1. Okay, and then we're going to go into the interface, which I'm pretty sure is f00, and it is int f0/0. This is the router on a stick, so all we do is no shut. So we're going to create sub interfaces. All right, so I'm just going to up arrow, .100. I usually create VLAN 1. I'm not going to at this point, or I'm not really going to. I'm just going to create the VLANs that we have working with us. All right, VLAN 100, which is the faculty VLAN. Okay, then we're going to do incap .1q. It must match the VLAN ID number. So in this case, it's 100. Now, I use the same number for the sub interface for visualization purposes. That is all. All right, so you know, hey, this is VLAN 100, okay? But this one must match the .1q, the encapsulation command. That number must match the VLAN ID or you will not get communication. Okay, and now you can put the default gateway, which is IP address. and I forget. I think it's 100 actually. So I try to put everything the same. 100.0, there it is. Okay, so IP address 192.168.100.254. I always use the last available, 255.255.255.0. Enter. And then we're gonna do the same exact thing for VLAN 101. So I can just go back up, VLAN 101, right? Sub interface, end cap, one, and then the IP address is 101. Awesome. Do WR. Now remember, our PCs are dynamically, they want a dynamic address. So they're not gonna work yet, but let's test it out. But we wanna verify what we did. A good command to show IP in brief. Okay, we see the sub interfaces are created right here, .100, .101, and we have the correct gateway addresses, and it's up. All right, and you can see that the physical interface is up as well. You must turn on the physical interface, or else is, you know, you can create sub interfaces all day, every day, nothing's gonna happen. All right, another command that's similar to this, just to show you, show protocols. All right, it's pretty much the same thing, but you get the subnet mask along with it, where here you do not, here you do. All right, here you do. All right, so we got that going. We can test it really through the server, because the server has a static IP address, does it not? All right, see, we're in the 101. So let's see if we can ping our own gateway. So let's maximize this puppy, shall we? And nice black screen ping 192.168.101.254, and we get a reply from our old gateway, which is a good sign, right? Let's see if we can get from the 100.254. So it seems that we have connectivity to the other network. So what we need to do, it seems to be working. Just because you can ping the gateway doesn't mean you can ping the PC, but obviously here we can't ping the PC because we have an OPPA. So we need to create a DHCP pool for this particular network, the 100 network. Okay, so we're gonna go back to the router, all right? And we're gonna create a DHCP server right on the router. All right, so we're gonna do IP DHCP. I'm gonna do a question mark, and you can exclude addresses. You can do all these different things, all right? And we could exclude the DNS address, which is the 101.1. So we can actually do that, exclude address 192.168.101.1, which is our DNS server, so it doesn't get assigned, right? If that would be DHCP on the other side, we can exclude that address from ever being assigned. That's fine. And then we can go ahead and do, so you can see it doesn't take us into DHCP configuration mode. Now, when you do IP DHCP pool, and you just call it LAS, right? Whatever. We should have called the faculty, but what have you. All right. It takes you into DHCP configuration mode. Now, here you have certain commands for that particular pool. So what's the default router for this particular site? So this is the 192.168.100.254. That is the default router. That is what's on that sub interface, okay? Then we'll do the DNS server. DNS server is 192.168.101.1, okay? And what network am I in? I'm in the network 192.168.100.0 space. You gotta put the subnet mask here. Boom, done, okay? Do WR. And then control Z, show start. And then we can go through the start and we can take a look at this. All right, there's your sub interface, there's your IP address. Did I do a WR? No, show start. Ah, because it usually shows up at the beginning. So I was wondering, hey, where's it at? There it is, your excluded address, and there's your pool. So let's take a look at the PCs. Let's see if they're getting assigned an IP address. All green light. This right here, it's something I do not like. Something's going, I do not like that, because that will create, there has to be a block port, span tree, something going on, is going on with span tree, but okay. Let's go ahead here. Let's do a release renew. Just by doing that, that's what it is. There we go. We got the 100.1 with the DNS. Okay, and let's go here. And you see it got it by itself. Again, Packet Tracer has its little bugs. Okay, but here, I don't know why it did that. Okay, because you should have a blocked port. This is your root bridge. Let's take a look at Spanning Tree, shall we? Show Spanning Tree. All right. We have, keep going down. And it doesn't show. This obviously is the root bridge, which is not what I assigned it to begin with. So, since I am here, config T. All right, spanning tree, VLAN 1. Something like this happens, you can do it after the fact. VLAN 1, comma, VLAN 10, comma, not 10, wow, 100, comma, 101. Priority 0. Oops, misspelled priority, that's why I tab. 0, okay, do WR. Now there should be some changes going on here. Now you see that that's working the way it should. Now this port is blocked. Because everything, if you get all green lights, you're going to create a broadcast storm. So let's take a look at spanning tree again, shall we? Let's WR this. Show spanning tree. Now this is the root bridge. Okay. Now this is what I'm looking for. And this particular switch here should show us enable, show spanning tree, and we should have some ports blocked, and we do. We have a blocked port. What? Root ports. That's crazy. Okay, layer 3 switch. Again, it has a root port, which is port 22. That makes sense. Port 22 is a root port, but port 21, it's a blocked port. That's root. It's not showing us are blocked. Oh, well, it says blocked, but it's calling it root. This is true. Okay. This is not true. It should be alternating block, not root block. But okay. We are running rapid spanning tree. Okay. But that should not, it should be an alternating block right here. But it is blocked, and that's what we want. All right. That's what we want, because if not, we create that broadcast storm. So we've done STP, VTP, we've done VLANs, we've trunk, we've done inter VLAN, we did DHCP on the router. And finally, we're going to do DNS, right? We're going to turn on DNS. DNS is the on by default, the service, all right? And I'll the command is already there, it's on. So I'll just show you what the command is. Config T, IP, oops, because remember, you always want to negate something, you put no in front of it, all right? So IP domain, hyphen, lookup. That turns DNS on, but it's already on. IP name hyphen server. And I want to keep it like I did here. So we did, I believe, last.com. Last.com. So I'm just going to call it last.com. I'm going to call it las. I'm sorry. It's or last.com. Last.com. IP name server, last.com. Oops. IP name server last. Okay. What are you looking for? An IP address. Oh, yes. Yes, yes, yes. Okay. 192.168.101.1. And IP domain hyphen name. Excuse me. Last.com. Okay, sorry about that. Now that we have that done, DNS, do WR. All right, there's so many things we can do with it. There's many things we can do with it. We can actually go into DNS. All right, and again, this is not a real DNS server, people. All right, we can configure DNS. We know about host records, or we should. All right, and I can say R1. www.ipadmin.com, and we can add an IP address to it. We're going to do 192.168.1.254. You can click add, and we're going to do the same thing again, r1.com, and then we can add, well, there's only one IP address, isn't there? Well, we're going to do two, really, 192.168. Ooh, hold on for a second. 100.254, okay? In a real DNS, we have to delete and redo it. I think we can edit it, though, R1. Okay, so we got R1. Let's save that. So now we're going to do... R1.com, but we're going to do 101. We're going to add that one. So we have two IP addresses there that are associated with this one. So let's see if we can ping. Let's exit. Control Z. Ping R1. But you see that it's looking for this right here. Okay, so let's do ping r1.com, because that indeed is the A record. Okay, so you can go ahead and do that. So again, DNS could be used for that. Also, if you're doing SSH, you need a domain name and a host name. So if you were to configure SSH, config T, right, you would do IP SSH, authentication retries. You want to let people try to log in three times. IP, not TCP, IP SSH, sorry. Timeout is 120 seconds, all right? Now we go into line VTY, which are your tunnel lines, 0 space 15. And oops, I forgot something. But I'm gonna continue here. I'm gonna do line con 0, password Cisco, login local, because I'm actually going to put a username on there for it. But the important command here is transport input, okay, transport output, define which protocols to use for outgoing, okay. A little different on the layer 3 switch. We're going to say all. Okay. Interesting. Now, we're going to create a username and password. Okay. So we're going to do username, LDS, and no. Oh, I just misspelled username, LDS. Okay. Privilege level is 1 through 15. There is documentation on each level of what each level does. Okay, if you're all gung-ho, go ahead and find out what they are. But usually they give you administrative rights to the router. Privilege 15. Okay. And then you're gonna do password. 0, plain text, or 7, which is encrypted. Password 0, and you know, we just do Cisco. All right, do WR. So let's take a look at that. See what we have. Show start all the way to the bottom. Then we have password Cisco, login local, which is what we want to do. So let's test this. We're getting an IP address here, so let's test interconnectivity first. If we can get to the other side, we're able to get to that one. So let's up arrow, let's do 100.1, and that should be one of the PCs. All right, obviously we have ARP. There we go. So we do have interconnectivity, which is great. So now let's try SSH. SSH minus L. Oh, that's an equal sign. Where are my glasses? Minus L, LDS. And then the IP address, which is 192.168.101, because I'm in the server, .254. Init valid command, IP SSH, isn't that the name? Let's go back up here and check. take a look at that. Show start, small configuration. So we can just use show start to go down. And I don't see it. Okay. Login logo. Okay, login. Let's see if we can tell it. Let's see if it allows us to telnet into a router. Telnet 192.168.101.254. No. It doesn't let us. All right then. That's interesting. That is exactly how you would do it. And I don't even see here in the configuration when we just did. We enabled SSH on the router, but I do not see it here. Oh, yes. Config T, we did DNS, right? We did SSH, but we didn't do this. Okay. Crypto key generate RSA 512. There we go. SSH is enabled now. Control T, show start. Let's take a look. It's little things like this that get you just every time. There it is right there, SSH version 1, domain name, blah, 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 blah. All right, awesome. Let's see if now it wants to work. I tell it should have worked, I don't know why that, okay. Okay, let's see if it's because of its uppercase, SSH. Minus ideas 192.168.101.254. Okay. Let's take the configuration again. This is what I love about IT. Things need to go wrong for you to be able to actually make things happen. Okay. R1, there's your DHCP. LDS caps. Okay, the level, so it's there. SSH is enabled. Login local is there. Let's go back into those teller lines. Config T. Line VTY 0 space 15. Transport. Oh, once I did the crypto key, now I have input. Input all UWR. Okay. Layer 3 switches. Lovely. Or packet tracer, who knows? Okay. No. Oh, that want this. All right. Invalid command. Case sensitivity. Type in the IP address. Okay, SSH. Usage SSH minus L, okay. SSH minus L, the username, which is L Diaz, or in this case, L Diaz, and then the target, which is 192.168.101.254. That is the IP address. Okay, all right. So what do we do different? Oh, I was forgetting the minus L, because oh, look what I put, L, and then it was like together. Since it's LDS, okay, so I was forgetting to put this, okay? So password is Cisco, in uppercase, Cisco. C-I-S-C-O. No? C-I-S-C-O. Okay. It is Cisco. And get my glasses on. C-I-S-C-O. Also, what it could be asking is, I don't have a console. Well, I'm telnetting. It should be that. Let's close this. Let's close this. Let's go to the router again. All right, let's take a look at our passwords. It says I haven't encrypted anything. Show start. This is what I love. I'm telling you, this is great. Okay, username. It is Cisco. So, you know what? We're going to do some simple thing here. And even that one, password Cisco. I mean, everything is Cisco. Oh, looky, looky. I didn't put anything here. In the line count zero, password Cisco, login local, line VTY, I didn't put login local here. Isn't that something? Okay. All right. No problem. Config T. And just in case, we'll just do this. Enable password Cisco, line VTY, 0 space 15. Login local. All right, so we got that going. Do WR. So little silly things, but you gotta know what you're looking for and what's going on. Up arrow, and the password Cisco, C-I-S-C-O. Yay, and we're in, okay? Show start. Lovely. And that's it. That's all there is to it. Just remember, I mean, these are a lot of commands, but again, repetition breeds retention. That's what you need to do. That is what you need to do, okay? And you'll be fine. All right, just create the lab from scratch. If you want to use a layer 2 switch, just to make things even simpler, because there is no layer 3 switching in the CCNA, it's completely up to you. I did it with a layer 3 switch, just for the heck of it. All right, do it, okay? Mimic the lab. You see what's there. You can plug into whatever port that makes sense to you, all right? But if you want to just mimic it, you know, mirror it, then that's fine, okay? Oh, just one last thing before I let you go. I did do email, okay? I did do email here, and the way that you would do that, because this is like web services, you go to email, you actually create user accounts here in labs.com, and then through here in the desktop, you create their email account. So I did that. Well, let's just do it through here since we're here. So I'm going to compose an email to who? To ldiaz@labs.com, subject, test, and you say hello, and see if it sends it. All right, so apparently it's sent, okay? I think, is this LDS? Let's see. Yes, this is LDS, okay? Well, I don't got anything so far. Nothing. Oh, yeah, here, received. There you go, I received from Dignadias. I received test, hello. So why am I showing you this? Because it's very easy to set up, and when you're doing access lists, you can actually block port 25 because we are using SMTP. But again, this is your lab for SCP, VTP, VLAN trunking, inter VLAN, creating DHCP and DNS on a router, and the reasons that we could use DNS on the router, not only for SSH, but for using it to ping host addresses as well. All right, hope you enjoyed it. I hope you got something out of it. Good luck to everybody.